Hi dear souls, good morning. Thank you for joining us, wherever you are joining us from. We are going to start our services today. Concentrate in our service, participate. We will be having a pre-recorded worship. Concentrate, worship in whatever way that God allows you to do. We will be following with a prayer, and then we'll be going into the message. For the prayer, Heavenly Father, thank you for this gathering. Thank you for today. In the name of Lord Jesus Christ, we pray to you. Just have your presence with us. Have your power. Be the Holy Spirit control all our service. In Jesus' name we are praying. Amen.
It's a beautiful time to give God praise. This song says, holy, holy, our God is holy. Amen. Can you put your hands together for Jesus? Come on. His word, yeah, oh, yeah, we give it glory, oh yeah, it's so worthy, holy, holy, Father, you are holy, there is no one else like you. Faithful, faithful, Father, you are faithful. We have put our trust in you. It's a very simple song. Can you try it? Holy, holy, Father, you are holy. There is no one else like you. Oh, faithful, faithful. Faithful, we have put our trust in you. Everybody, let's go one more time. Say, holy, 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 yeah. Father, you are holy. There is no one else like you. You are so faithful, faithful, faithful. Oh, Father, you are faithful. We have put our trust in you. Take it one more time, say, holy,
holy, holy,
oh, oh,
Father, you are holy, there is no one else like you.
Our God is so faithful,
faithful, faithful,
Father, you are faithful,
we have put our trust in you.
Your name. There is freedom. There is freedom to dance in your presence. Freedom to work in liberty. Hallelujah. We praise your name. Hey,
praise to the only living God. Praise to the only faithful one.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We praise your name.
There is freedom. There is freedom to dance.
In your presence, freedom to work in liberty.
Hallelujah. We praise your name. Let's take it from the top again. Put your hands together like this. Come on. Faithful, faithful, oh, Father, you are faithful. We have put our trust in you. Let's take it again, say, you are holy,
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 oh,
you are holy.
There is no one else,
no one else like you.
Let me hear you.
Faithful,
oh, 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 oh.
You are faithful.
We have put You're faithful. Oh, 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 oh.
You are faithful.
We have put our trust in you. You say, our God will rise.
Our God, you will.
We praise your name.
Freedom to walk in liberty, hallelujah. We praise your name.
You say, praise to the
only
living God.
Praise to the only faithful God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We praise your name.
There is freedom.
There is freedom to death.
Oh,
in your presence.
Yeah.
Freedom to work
in liberty.
In liberty.
This body says, hallelujah, 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 we praise your name. Can you put your hands up? Hallelujah, say hallelujah, hallelujah, we praise your name. Let me hear you say
hallelujah.
Make it
hallelujah.
To the only living God.
Hallelujah. We praise your name.
Say hallelujah. Yeah.
Hallelujah.
To the lion on the left.
Hallelujah.
To the King of glory.
Hallelujah.
We praise your name.
We praise your name.
One more time, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. To the
hallelujah.
Left.
Praise your name.
Say hallelujah.
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 We praise your name.
You say, praise to the only living God.
Praise to the only faithful one.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hey.
We praise your name.
One more time, say praise to the only.
Praise to the only living God.
Oh, praise to the only faithful one. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We praise your name.
There is freedom.
There is freedom to dance in your presence.
Freedom to work in liberty. Hallelujah. We praise your name. Put your hands together. Don't you God yeah. Oh, say hallelujah. We praise your name. Oh, push your hands together. It's so worthy. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We praise your name.
One more time, put your hands together. Oh,
praise your name.
Say praise to the only.
Praise to the only living God.
Praise to the only faithful God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We praise your name.
There is freedom.
There is freedom to dance in your presence.
Freedom to work in liberty. Hallelujah. We praise your name. The one who sits on the throne. Our God is holy. Is holy. Is holy. Nobody like our God. Nobody like our God. I want us to just lift up our hands to Him and just give Him glory. And just give Him glory. Hallelujah. is so worthy of our praise.
Say you are awesome. Nobody like
Awesome are you, King of glory. Awesome are you, King of glory. Somebody just raise a sound of worship. You're awesome in this place. Lift your hands to him. Call him the awesome God, King of kings, Lord of lords, everlasting Savior. You are the Redeemer. You are awesome in this place. You are awesome, Lord. You are awesome, Lord. You are awesome, God, yes. Yeah, hallelujah.
Hello, hello, hello. Welcome back. God bless you. I'm so delighted to be with you again this weekend. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you for all of you that join us from every part of the world. There's not a lot of you, but we appreciate the fact that you're watching from everywhere, and some of you do watch after the service is over. But if you're able to join us live like this, we really appreciate that, and God bless you. Thank you for joining us. And for the rest of us, the Leader's House, I know a lot of people have been sending me messages about, you know, the lockdown. I believe, God, that it's not going to be like the previous months that we've had. Hopefully the numbers in our province have been coming down now. So we are really, really trusting God that it would not go beyond this 1 month, and we'll be back together again very, very soon by the grace of God. My challenge to you, though, is that while we are not here, we need to make the most of the time, all right, and not lose all of the momentum that we've gained, you know, by gathering together. So always make sure that you're engaging with the services. It's important that you are able to join while the service is on, right, so that you maintain that discipline and that culture, right, and you don't just say, okay, I'm going to just watch it later on. It's not the same thing. We are honoring God with the time. That is very important to us. People who are not a part of the church can do that. They can watch the service later on, but you can't afford to do that. You need to make it a discipline that you maintain during this period, okay? All right, and one of the other messages that I got during the week was that I forgot to share a joke. I actually did not forget. I didn't forget. It was just the fact that, you know, I felt in my mind that I don't know how you would respond if you're not in the room. If you're in a room and I crack a joke, I know how, if you laugh, I know if it's funny or not, right? But if you're all right, I don't know how you're going to respond. So we'll try it today, all right? And I'll see what happens. But again, I don't know. I can't really judge, you know, if the joke is funny or it's not funny. But we'll see how it goes, right? So I'm going to read two. The first one might not be funny. I'll try with the second one. So let me know how it goes. So if by next week, the comment is like, there's no, this joke is not funny online, it's better when we're inside, and then I'll stop until we get back together again. I'm not going to run out of jokes. Trust me, I told you that my last trip in British Columbia, I used to put jokes in the bulletin. So I have a truckload of jokes that I can share with you, okay? So I'm not going to run out of jokes, alright? So let's try this. It says, a minister was testing the children in his church to see if they understood the concept of getting to heaven. He asked them, if I sold my house and my car and I had a big jumbo sale and gave all my money to the church, would that get me into heaven? No, the children answered. If I cleaned the church every day, looked after the grounds, and repainted the walls, would that get me into heaven? Again, the answer was, no. Well then, persisted the minister, if I was kind to animals and gave candy to all the children and loved my family, would that get me into heaven? Again, they all answered, no. Now the minister was surprised, so he continued, okay, so what then would get me into heaven? Then the six-year-old boy shouted and said, you have to die first. Okay, so that's the first step to get to heaven. You have to die, okay? Now, this second one is Mr. Seamus. You remember him. This is the man that told the pastor that it's me and you are the ones that are left standing. Remember that guy? He's the same guy. All right, so Mr. Seamus, he left the pub. It was worse for wear. He had been drinking. So he sat down on a bus next to a priest. His tie was stained, his face was plastered with red lipstick, and a half-empty bottle of whiskey was sticking out of his torn coat pocket. He opened the newspaper and began reading. Then he asked the priest, Reverend Father, what causes arthritis? The priest took a long, hard look at him and answered, well, my son, arthritis is the result of sinful living, being with cheap, promiscuous women, drinking too much whiskey, and just having a contempt for your fellow man. Wow, Mr. Seamus muttered, and then returned to reading his newspaper. Then the priest began to feel a little guilty about what he had said and said, "You know, I'm very sorry, I didn't mean to upset you. So how long have you had arthritis?" Mr. Simmons looked at the priest and said, "I don't have arthritis, Reverend Father. I was just reading in this newspaper that the Pope has it." So everything that he said, you know, is supposed to be applicable to the Pope? No, it's not. Okay. All right. So let me know how that went, all right? If our jokes online don't work, then we'll just wait until you all come back here. But I miss you guys. I actually miss the fact that, you know, you can when you preach to people in the room, it's different from when people are online. It's very different, trust me. Like I said, there's a couple of us in the room today again, but it's not the same thing, honestly. It's not the same thing. I prefer it when I can see your faces, but I trust God, because the Bible says we walk by faith and not by sensory perception. Okay, so I trust God that God is in control and that you are out there and you are doing well and everything is fine with you. Alright, so let's take our confession and get into the message today. I'll try to preach as quickly as I can today. Alright, say this with me, say it every day. And in every way, I am becoming more like Jesus. I am becoming more like Jesus. Say it louder, I am becoming more like Jesus. Say in my thoughts, in my words, and in my actions, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we have come before your word again today like people that have found a great treasure. We ask for eyes that see and ears that hear, hearts that understand who we are in Christ, who Christ is in us. As for me, that you anoint me and my lips of clay, let your word come unhindered and unchecked by any outside force, so that at the end of this message, your people will be edified and your name alone will be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, so we've been talking fit for the fight, and I told you last week that the series may not be over. So what I believe that the Spirit of God will have me do today is to talk to you about how to win the fight. How to win the fight. So today we're going to talk about our weapons, our enemy, and our armor. Alright, these are the three major things that I want to talk to you about today. So this really is the three things that you need to actually win this fight. We'll be talking about being fit. Last week we talked about, you know, being vessels unto honor. We've set those foundations right. So today let's look at what is this fight? How do we win it? You know, we know what the fight is by now, but how do we actually win this fight? Understanding again that we are fighting from a winning position. Don't forget that. We are fighting a fight that Jesus has already won. Okay? But how do we enjoy the benefits of it? That's what we mean by win the fight. How do we enjoy the benefits of what Jesus has already procured for us? So let's go back to 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 12. This is where we started this series from. 1 Timothy 6 and verse 12. It says, "Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses." Paul told Timothy, he said, fight the good fight of faith. And we made it clear that we are in a fight. We are in a fight. We need to understand that and we need to embrace that reality, because our enemy understands that we are in a fight and he is fighting. The Bible says he goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Alright, so he is actively working hard to make sure that Christians are derailed from the plan and the purpose of God for their lives. And it is only those Christians who don't understand that we're in a fight, those are the ones that he is going to get, all right? Now, having said that, the nature of this fight is not physical. We have established that. It's not a physical fight. We are not fighting with people. We are not fighting with human beings. But that's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, from verse 3 to verse 5, 2 Corinthians 10, 3 to 5, it says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh." Look at that. "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds." It says, "The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds, for casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." So our weapons are not carnal. In other words, our weapons are not physical weapons, but because it is not a physical fight. Okay? The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. So today we're going to look at these weapons. What are our weapons? what really are these weapons? All right, so I'm going to break that down for you today, give you the examples of what these weapons represent. Not an exhaustive list, but at least a working list that you can make use of. All right, to understand what our weapons are, to understand who our enemy is, and then we'll take a look at this armor that we have. All right. And in order to be able to win this fight that we're fighting, it's a spiritual fight, all right? That's where we are in, it's not a physical one. Now, let's look at this issue of strongholds that he talks about in verse 4. He says, for the weapons of our warfare, not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. So the purpose of the weapons is for us to pull down strongholds. So we need to have an idea what strongholds are, so that we are not chasing shadows. We're not running after the wrong thing. We understand what we are aiming for. When you have a weapon with you, let's say a bow and arrow, you need to know exactly what you are aiming at. For you to hit a target, there has to be a target. So the target here is stronghold. So let's try to understand what strongholds are. And I looked this up in the original text, and this is what the word strongholds, this is what it means from the Greek. It means to fortify through the idea of holding safely. It's a figurative expression of a castle, an argument, a fortress. So strongholds typically are things that the enemy has built in the lives of people. Ideas that, you know, things that have become like a fortress, like a castle that he has spent time building. Sometimes in people's family line, from generation to generation, he has spent so much time building yokes in people's life. Things that you would be discussing with people, people will be arguing with you that this is right, but you know that this is not really right, because the enemy has built a stronghold in people's lives with those arguments. All right, so I want you to pay attention to this word, because it will become very important to us in a moment. All right, but this expression, I drew it out because this is the only time in the New Testament that this word was used. This is the only time that it appears in the New Testament, and it is very specific. It's a very specific choice of a rare word, because it was the only word that accurately conveyed the idea that he wanted to pass along to the church in Corinth. So we need to understand that when the Bible, you know, makes use of words, they are deliberately chosen words. That's why I like to break down words in the Bible to understand what the expression really means. So when you say somebody has a stronghold, it is something that exists in the mind of people. It's not a physical monument, because this is not a physical fight. It is something that exists in people's mindsets, in the way that they see things, in the way that they perceive things, in the way they view life. When things happen to people, the way that they respond, those things come out of a place in people's hearts. It's a place called strongholds. It is castles, things that, ideas, you know, that, okay, we'll be talking to people telling you, this is how we do it. You know, in my family, when people are 35 years old, this is what happens to them, you know? And they have embraced it as a pattern, as something that is consistent with their own lives, and they've accepted it. It's a stronghold. So these are the things, arguments, and people will be arguing with you about, you know, things that are not even, you know, scriptural, things that don't exist in the Word of God. They'll be arguing with you that, oh, you know, this is correct. But you tell them that this is what the Bible says. You say, no, this is what my father told me. So those things are arguments, they are strongholds. They are things that the enemy has taken time to build into people's lives, and they have to be broken down. So we want to look at the weapons now. How to win the fight of faith. I have 3 points of message. Point number one, you need to know who your enemy is. 3 things you need. You need to know who your enemy is. That's point number one. Know your enemy. Anybody that is in any kind of military will tell you that the first thing that you need to understand when you're going into war is to understand your enemy. I don't like talking about the devil. I don't spend time talking about him at all, because the devil is not a big deal. Trust me. I don't care what anybody has taught you. I don't care where you're coming from. The devil is not a big deal. The devil is a defeated foe. That's who he is. He's a defeated foe. So he's not a big deal. But in order to win this fight, we need to know who our enemy is, and know who our enemy is not. That is even more important to me. Because you see, many people know who the enemy is, but they assume that other people are the enemy. So to win this fight, you need to know who your enemy is. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Describes our enemy. Look at what it says. 1 Peter 5 verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, do you see that? Your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So who is your adversary? The devil. The devil is your adversary. Your adversary is not your husband.
Your adversary is not your wife. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's not your enemy. Because you can, sometimes, I know sometimes you feel like your wife is the enemy, but your wife is not the enemy. The enemy is who? Satan. Satan is the enemy, alright? So you need to understand and appreciate that. Your culture around you, right? And so many Christians are so averse to the culture. People, they think that the world, social media is the enemy, or, you know, young people are the enemy. Young people, these young people, they are the ones that are causing all this trouble. Young people are not your enemy. The enemy is the devil. Satan is the enemy. Sometimes he may use people, alright? He may use people who make themselves available, but those people are not your enemy. The truth is, Satan really doesn't like to use people. I know that might sound strange to you, but let me tell you the truth. Satan, he has a team of people. And I'll show you in Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12, he says it there. He says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So Satan has a team. He has people he can use, demons that he can use. He would rather use them than use people. There's a difference between when the devil uses people and when God uses people. The devil doesn't use people to let them go. He uses people to destroy. Because the Bible says he comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's what Satan knows how to do. It is when God uses somebody that the person is promoted, that the person is elevated, that the person's life becomes better. So those are two different kinds of uses. So when Satan wants to use, the demons that Satan uses, they already know their end. They know their faith. So they know that they are going to be destroyed at the end of the day, right? So the devil would rather use, you know, the demons, and those are because he has trained them. They understand his ways. They know who he is. They know what he's about. And they will do whatever he tells them to do, all right? So he would rather not rely on human beings. So he only uses humans when there's no other way around it. Then he convinces people to do certain things and behave in certain ways just to manipulate, you know, the situation. The other truth about the devil is that the devil is not omnipotent. He's not omnipotent, he's not omniscient. He cannot be in more than one place at a time. I know you think the devil is very powerful. So some of this is what I'm saying. It might sound very strange to you. The devil is not as powerful as you think. He's not as powerful as you think. That's why you need to know your enemy. Your enemy is not as powerful as God. I know there's some Christians who believe more in the power of the devil to do evil than in the power of God to save them. There are Christians who believe that. That if somebody comes now and brings a fetish and says, I'm going to spray this thing on you and you will go blind, they will run away. But if a pastor brings the word of God and says, I'm going to pray for you, they will say, are you called? Are you a real pastor? They will still be doubting that. But they don't doubt fetish. When they see fetish, they will run away. Because they have more faith in the power of the charm to cause harm to them than in the power of the word of God to bless them. So this cannot be our story. We cannot be like this. You need to understand who the devil is. He cannot be in more than one place at a time. He doesn't have all power. The Bible says all power in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus. So you need to understand that as long as you're on the side of Jesus, you're on the side of all power. Say amen to that. All right, stay with me. Let's keep going. So he may use people who make themselves available, but people are not the enemy. He has a team that he prefers to use, all right? So the enemy attacks us through something called fairy darts, through arguments, imaginations, thoughts. That's what he uses. He uses thoughts and ideas. He brings thoughts to your mind. And when he's bringing thoughts to your mind, it's not the devil really that is doing it. Listen, if you tell me that you have seen the devil before, you are lying. The devil doesn't have time to play small. He plays big. He goes after big targets. So if the devil has appeared to you before, it's because you are causing havoc to his kingdom. It's not just going to come and show up in your house. The people that the devil has appeared to are people that are disturbing him, disturbing his kingdom, not people that are running away from him. Alright, so it's probably the thoughts that a demon or a familiar spirit or one of these things that we've read here, principalities, powers, that they bring thoughts and ideas. But they all have only one weapon. And these weapons are called fairy darts. They are wiles, schemes, lies, deception. That is all the devil uses. He doesn't have any other weapon but lies. Behind every stronghold is a lie, is a belief that has been strongly held, an argument that is opposing God's will. That's what a stronghold is. So it's an argument that he has formulated in the minds of people over time that they have believed so strongly in that it's so difficult, even when they see the truth and they hear God's word or they read God's word and they see the truth, they find it difficult to accept it because there's a stronghold. There's a stronghold. That's why it says those weapons are not carnal, they are mighty through God to pull down those strongholds. And we'll see what those weapons are in a moment. Okay, just stay with me. Now, let's talk about arguments. When we're saying what strongholds mean, let's look at what arguments are. Because these are things that oppose God's will in people's lives. Have you ever met somebody who you are trying to talk to, maybe about Jesus, and they come up with this sophisticated argument on why there's no God? This is it. It's the devil. This is one of his weapons. He has put arguments and composed things that sound so lofty in the minds of people that they feel like, there's nobody that can beat this. This is the reason why I believe that there's no God. And you look at the whole argument, and from the foundation, it's based on a lie that the enemy has told them over time. So what are arguments? Let me just show you here. So it says, casting down arguments. Look at 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 to 5. Casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So these arguments are logical arguments that counsel against God. This is what the word arguments used there means in the Greek. These are logical arguments. When you hear it, it sounds logical. That, this is very, well thought out. But the enemy is the one behind it. And what the purpose is to counsel people against God, to make people believe that there is no God. The Bible says that the God of this world has blinded the minds of people. When people come up with this idea in their mind that, I'm enlightened, I'm not religious, I'm enlightened. And all these religious people, they've been brainwashed. When people start talking like that, the Bible says the God of this world has blinded their eyes, that they cannot see the truth. They can't see the truth. So they talk like that, thinking that they are enlightened, but it is the devil who is behind those arguments. It's the one who is behind those concepts, those thoughts, those ideas in the minds of people. Alright, so Satan is a liar. You need to know your enemy. Satan is a liar. He is the father of lies. He uses arguments and lies as tools of attack. Those are his major tools. Lies, deception, arguments. But everything is founded on lies. John chapter number 8, verse 44. This is what Jesus told us. John chapter 8, verse 44. Here's what it says. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. There is no truth in Satan. If Satan tells you that it is summer, please go outside, because it cannot be summer. Satan does not know how to say the truth. It's the same way that God cannot lie. That's what the Bible says. God cannot lie. So if God tells you that this pulpit is black, the minute he says it, even if it was not black, it becomes black, because he doesn't have the capacity to tell a lie. But the opposite is true of Satan, because if Satan tells you that the cloth you are wearing is black, then, my friend, go and check it. Satan does not have the ability to speak the truth. So even when he says something that sounds right, there's always a lie in it. I'll show you in the Bible here. I'll show you from the story of Adam and Eve. Just stay with me 1 second. Now, this, look at it, verse 44. Let's go back there. It says, when he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Look at it. It says, when he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources. So, anytime that you tell a lie, you are making use of Satan's resources. He says, lying is his resources. So, Satan, his weapons, his toolbox, is full of lies. So, every time you start using lies as a weapon to get out of things, you are making use of Satan's resources. He says, Satan is the father of lies. He's the father of lies. You don't want to align yourself with Satan's tools. So this is all that he doesn't have any new tricks. His strategy has been lying from the beginning, and that's what he continues to use. Let's go to Genesis, and let me show you what I'm talking about here. This is how he started this entire thing. He started with lies. Now, Genesis chapter 3, from verse 1 to verse 5. Genesis 3, 1 to 5. It says, now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, as God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. This is what he's asking. He says, did God say you should not eat of every tree of the garden? You see where he's going now. Verse number 2. And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruits of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it. God did not say that. You see, he has confused the woman. Now he's saying that God said don't touch it, but God didn't actually say that. Lest you die. Look at it there. He says, the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die, For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Question, were they like God? At the time that Satan was telling them this, were they or were they not like God? They were already like God. But he came and said, when you eat of this thing, you're going to be like God. You see that? So he is always about lying, he's always about manipulation, and he deceived them, and they believe that, okay, if we eat this thing, we'll be like God. But they were already like God. So he's going to come to you and try to tell you that if you do things in a certain way, change the figures in your office, you will become wealthy. But you are already wealthy. He will tell you that the only way for you to be happy is to go out of your marriage and commit adultery. But you are already happy. See, these are things that God has already made you. That you need to just understand that this is who I am in Christ. And then lay hold on that and not listen to the lies of the enemy. The major tool that the enemy has is lies. Deception and lies. Those are his major tools. Interestingly, it doesn't actually take much to get rid of the devil. The Bible says all we need to do is to submit to God and resist the devil, and he will flee from us. That's in James chapter 4, verse 7, and I'll show you that. He says we need to resist him. But then let's go back to 1 Peter first. 1 Peter chapter 5, from verse 8 to 9, and let me show you that. He says, be sober, be vigilant, your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Then verse 9 says, I'm going too fast, resist him. You see that? Resist him, steadfast in the faith. That's what we've been talking about for so long, this issue of faith, and how you need to make the word of God on your lips the tool that you need to respond to the devil, bringing every thought into captivity. So when an evil thought comes to your mind, it's not to take it away. You need to respond with your words, with the word of God on your lips, okay? It says resisting, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brother in the world. So, James chapter 4 verse 7, it says, therefore, submit to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. If we have some time, we're going to talk a bit more about submitting at the end of the message. He says, submit to God. That's the first thing. And then resist the devil. As long as you are submitted to God and you resist the devil, he will flee from you. It's not a guesswork. It's not something that the devil is going to think about. When we came into this place and we put on the light, no matter how dark it is in the room, the minute you put on the light, the darkness doesn't say, wait a minute, should I go? Or should I say? There's no argument. There's no question. The minute the light comes on, darkness has to run. So the minute you submit to God and resist the devil, he has to flee from you. He has to flee. That's what the word of God says. Say amen to that. Alright, so let's look at point number two. You need to know your weapons. Now, we've said you need to know your enemy. That's point number one. Point number two, you need to know your weapons. You need to understand what your weapons are. I'm going to share with you three major weapons that we use against the devil. This is not an exhaustive list, like I said, I'm just showing you the basic ones, and we'll talk about the others, okay? So these are the three major weapons. Weapon number one is the word. That's the word of God. We already talked about this a little bit last week. Weapon number one is the word. Hebrews chapter number 4 verse 12 says, for the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This is the word of God. Jesus used the word against the devil, and so should we. This is what Jesus used against the devil. He used God's word, and that is the tool that we also have to use. If Jesus had to rely on the word, we have to do the same. Remember what happened in Matthew chapter 4, verse 5 to 7. This is when Jesus was being tempted by the devil. It says, then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, look at the devil, he's using the scripture, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against the stone. Jesus said to him, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. So, it's not about what is written, it's about what is also written. Jesus said, it is written again. In other words, it is, I know that is written, but it is also written. It is also written, because in the mouth of two or three witnesses, a matter shall be established. So, it's not just about taking one scripture out of context. It's about checking out where it is also written. So, Jesus understood the word and used the word against the devil. Satan will always try to misuse the word. He will always try to misuse the word to you because he knows you know the word. He knows you are being taught the word. He knows that you understand that the word of God is your weapon. He will try to use it against you because he is the father of lies. The word is not Satan's weapon. The word is our weapon. But he will always try to use it against us. Because the only thing he knows how to do is not to create anything. It is to manipulate what is already created and make misuse out of it. Okay? This is important for us to understand. Weapon number two, the blood. The blood. We're still talking know your weapons. But this is number two under that is the blood. We've said the first one is the word of God. We've said the second one now is the blood. Revelations chapter number 12. Verse 11, Revelations 12, 11. Weapon number two is the blood. Revelations 12, 11 says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. So the blood of Jesus is our major weapon. I've told you before that we plead the blood of Jesus against Satan's arguments. So this is why I explained to you that the blood of Jesus is not something that you pour on your head when you say you plead the blood. That's not what you're saying. You say, I plead the blood. It does not mean that I'm sprinkling the blood like in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, we plead the blood of Jesus with the hyssop of our tongue. That's how we plead the blood. And what are we pleading the blood against? Against strongholds. Against every argument. It's a legal term. So you are coming to the court. The devil is arguing. He's bringing up these strongholds, this argument. And you are saying, I plead the blood. In other words, how do you plead? Do you plead guilty or not guilty? You say, I plead the blood. In other words, I rest my case on the blood of Jesus. Don't forget this. This is what it means. I don't care what your theology has been from when you were a child. What it means to plead the blood is what I'm telling you. Because what you are fighting against are strongholds. They are arguments that the devil is breaking. And when you get to a law court and they're bringing up arguments, they ask you, how do you plead? You plead what? You plead the blood. So the blood of Jesus is our weapon. You have every right to say, as the devil is bringing thoughts and arguments into your mind, to say, I plead the blood of Jesus. And you need to have an understanding that you are not saying the blood is covering me like liquid. No, you are saying, I'm under the covering of the blood of Jesus. Anything, any argument that the blood of Jesus cannot overcome, I rest my case under the blood of Jesus. Alright? Say amen to that. Weapon number three is the name of Jesus Christ. So we're on number three, but we're still talking about know your weapons, okay? Weapon number three is the name itself, the name of Jesus. So the word, the blood, the name. Mark chapter number 16 from verse 17 to 18. Mark 16, 17 to 18. Look at what it says. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. And they will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. The trick here is, it says, these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. In my name, they will do all of these things. So the name of Jesus is a weapon that we have. You have to learn to use the name. You have to learn to use the name. So every time you pray or you are declaring something, even when I'm praying in tongues, I interject it with the name of Jesus. Every time I'm praying, because I don't know what I'm praying, I don't understand it, but one thing is sure. One of my weapons is the name. So you hear me say all the time, as I'm praying, I'm praying in tongues, and I interject it all the time in the name of the Lord Jesus. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Because the name is a weapon that we have, and we need to use it. We use the name of Jesus against strongholds. We resist the devil with these weapons. These are the weapons that we use to resist him. When the Bible says resist the devil, this is what he's talking about. You use the name of Jesus, you use the word of God, you use the blood of Jesus to resist him. Point number three. I hope you're still with me. Point number three now, you need to put on your armor. So we've said you need to know your enemy, you need to know your weapons, and number three, you need to put on your armor. And I need you to stay with me on this one, okay, because this is a little bit heavy. I'm not going to go into details with it, but it's really loaded. So to win this fight, you need the armor of God. There's something in the Bible, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 10. So put on your armor is point number three. Put on your armor. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 10 to 18. It's called the armor of God. The whole armor of God is what the Bible calls it. Alright, so it says from verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. In other words, the complete armor of God. That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. So those wiles are those arguments, the lies, the deception of the enemy, the fairy darts that he tries to throw at you. Then he says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore,
take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Little wonder we spend so much time talking about faith here, because it says, above all, taking the shield of faith. This is how you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Above all, take the shield of faith. Take the helmet of salvation. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Then verse 18 says, praying always. So this is also part of it. Prayer is also part of the armor. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. So from this passage that we've read, let me show you what the list of the armors are. Alright, there's seven of them. And seven, as you know, in scripture is a number of perfection. So there's a belt of truth. We're not going to be able to go through all of this in another teaching, another time. We'll break each one of them down. Okay, I'm just listing them out from this scripture today. There's the belt of truth. There is the breastplate of righteousness, which is the one that maybe when I'm teaching on that, I'll show you the image of it. All right, there's a breastplate of righteousness, of what a Roman soldier looked like in those days. And then there is the shoe of peace. And if you look at the New Living Translation, it says, for shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news. All right, so there's the shoe of peace, and then the shield of peace is also a weapon, all right? And then there is the shield of faith that he talks about, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is God's word, and then there is prayer, all right? So belt of truth, the Bible says Jesus was full of grace and truth, John chapter 1, verse number 14. For the peace, like I said, is a weapon. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14, to follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man will see God. And we also know clearly that peace is one of the ways that God leads us. Peace is one of the ways that God guides us. So peace is a weapon that we have. There is the shield of faith. There is the helmet of salvation. There is the sword of the Spirit. The word of God on your lips is the sword of the Spirit. And there is prayer. Prayer is a mighty weapon. It's one of the, it's the one, well, that's why probably it's listed as the last one. It's the weapon through which you actually disseminate all these other ones, all right? When you release the missiles, it's in prayer that you are able to do that. To confess God's word, to declare the word of God, to plead the blood of Jesus, you know, to use the name of Jesus, it's in prayer that you are able to do this. So you need the whole thing. You need the entire armor. Yeah, that's why he keeps saying, he said it twice. He said, put on the whole armor. Put on the whole armor. You cannot leave one out. You can't leave one out. Just like the Roman soldier, if they don't have a breastplate of righteousness, something can hit them there. If there's no helmet of salvation, something can hit them on the head. All right? All those different things are important. They're every single one of them. And you can't just have the shield of faith, which is a defensive weapon, and not have the sword of the Spirit, which is your offensive weapon. So all of these things are the ways that we fight this fight against our enemy, the devil. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Don't try to fight without your armor. This is how we win this fight. Don't try to fight without your armor. Don't try to fight without your weapons. Don't try to fight with head knowledge. Don't try to fight this fight that is a spiritual fight with carnal wisdom. Alright, so it's important that you understand this. Finally, you need to check your heart. To win this fight, you need the right heart. Because the Bible says, James chapter 4, that we read, it says, look at it, James 4 from verse 6, it says, but he gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God resists the proud. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So when we are saying that you will resist the devil and he will flee from you, this is the beginning point. God resists the proud. So you need to check your heart. Am I proud? This is the only thing that can stop you from being able to use these weapons and winning this fight against our adversary. So God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts. So we spent all of last week talking about this, that this is how we are made vessels unto honor. by purifying our hearts. It says, purify your hearts, you double-minded. So this is very important. In this world, you need a submitted heart. You need a submitted heart. There was a story in the Bible there where the disciples were asking Jesus, who is the greatest? They had gone out to do some work of evangelism and all of those things, and they had seen so many miracles. So they were coming back and they were arguing, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? It's in Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9 verse 33. They were saying, who's going to be the greatest? Then he came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, what was it you disputed among yourself on the road? But they kept silent, for on the road they had disputed among themselves who would be the greatest. And he sat down, called the 12, and said to them, if anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all. So the way to be fit for this fight, the way to win this fight, is to have the right heart. And the right heart is the heart of a servant. You need to understand this, that this is what the master is looking for. Alright, so I hope with these 3 points of mine, I've been able to convince you and not to confuse you. Don't forget, this is the goal. This is what we want to be able to say at the end of the day. 2 Timothy 4:7, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Can you say that with me? Say, I have fought the good fight. Say it one more time. Say, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. This is what is going to be our story, okay? So I want to give an opportunity to you out there. If you are watching today, you have never made Jesus the Lord of your life. The first step is to enlist in this army. That's the beginning point. Is to accept Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior and to come into this army of Jesus Christ. That is where you need to start from, okay? Romans chapter 10 verse 9. The Bible says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So I want you to say this simple prayer with me. If you're there, forget about who is with you, forget about where you are, who is beside you. You don't have to say the prayer out loud, just make sure you say it, because it says if you confess with your mouth, that's what you need to do. You need to confess with your mouth. Don't be ashamed. Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me in the presence of men, I will be ashamed of you before my Father. So he wants you to act. I know in your heart you want to respond, but you need to confess it as well. All right, so say this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, say it loudly, let him hear you. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe in my heart that God sent you to die for my sins. I confess with my mouth that he raised you from the dead on the third day. I accept you today as my Lord and as my personal Savior. Come into my life and do something with it. In Jesus' name. Now say, Holy Spirit, I receive you today. Say it one more time. Say, Holy Spirit of God, I receive you into my life by faith. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let me pray for you. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I want to thank you for every ear that has heard these words today. I thank you because your word says no one comes to you except your Father draws them. We thank you for drawing the hearts of those ones to you today. I ask in the name of Jesus that you accept them. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we forgive every sin, every unrighteousness in their lives, cleanse them, and make them new like your word promises us. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the rest of us, I pray, Father, that as we have heard these words, that these words will not stand against us on the day of judgment. That in this fight that we are in, Lord, you will help us to understand who our enemy is, to embrace our weapons, and to always put on the whole armor of God. In the mighty name of Jesus, and when we have done all, to be able to stand against every wild, against every fiery dart of the enemy. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. It's been a real pleasure bringing you God's word today. Thank you once again for all of you that provide feedback to us after every service. We bless God for you. Thank you very much. Maybe later on in the future, I will try to for a while we were here, I was reading some of those feedback, but just excuse me sometimes. I will try to read some of those comments to you and let you know some of the feedback that we're getting. Some people call them testimonies, alright? I just call them that because this testimony sounds very spiritual, okay? But we thank God for every single one of you. And if you'd like to, you can share the link of the service too as well, right? After the service is done, share the link with someone. Someone might be willing to watch it. A lot of people watch after the service than those who actually join while it is on. Alright, so let's do that, and God bless you. Please make sure you're engaging with all of our social media platforms. I'm going to make a few announcements next week about some of the things that are available for you to sign up for and a few of those kind of things. But I'm going to keep them in the cooler for now. All right, so just make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and our Instagram page. Okay, follow that page. We try to be as active as possible on Instagram there. For now, we're focusing on the social media platforms that we can effectively manage. We don't want to just be doing everything because everybody is everywhere. All right, so we only stream on YouTube for a reason, and we only maintain Instagram properly for a purpose. After a while, we're able to do all of those different other things. So just follow those pages, and we'll update you as we go along. I believe that's all there is right now. We're online, like for a while. Okay, we're going to be online like this for another four or five weeks. All right, so let's get used to that. Next Sunday though is Mother's Day. Okay, that's the Mother's Day service. So you want to join us for that? I will not tell you what's going to happen, but next Sunday is going to be different. Okay, that's all I can say. So join us for that. It is going to be different, and you will like it. It's going to be special. Okay, so God bless you. Thank you once again on behalf of myself, my wife, Dorcas, and every one of us here, everyone who has made this possible. I want to bless God for you. Thank you for joining us. I will see you again next Sunday. Until then, God bless you.